Okay, class, then we're in section 9.4, use square roots to solve quadratic equations. 9.4, use square roots to solve quadratic equations. Before, you solved a quadratic equation by graphing. Now you will solve a quadratic equation by finding square roots. Key vocabulary, square root, perfect square. Square root, perfect square. To use square roots to solve a quadratic equation of the form ax squared plus c is equal to zero, first isolate x squared on one side to obtain x squared is equal to d. Then use the following information about the solutions of x squared is equal to d to solve the equation. So go ahead and read the key concept before I begin to explain the examples. Example 1, solve quadratic equations. Solve the equation 2x squared is equal to a, then solve the equation m squared minus 18 is equal to a negative 18, and then solve the equation b squared plus 12 is equal to 5. Okay, we got 2x squared is equal to 8. We want to get the x squared by itself, so we divide both sides by 2, so x squared is equal to 4. After we get x squared is equal to 4, then we take the square root of both sides. All right, and that means I put the square root symbol on both sides. So I got the square root of x squared and the square root of 4. The square root of x squared is x. The square root of 4, remember, is plus or minus 2. The square root of 4 is not just positive 2, it's also negative 2. So the solutions are negative 2 and 2. All right, let's go on to B. M squared minus 18 is equal to a negative 18. I'm going to add 18 to each side. Plus 18 plus 18. All right, so this is going to cancel out. So I'm left with just M squared. This also cancels out, so I'm left with 0. A negative 18 plus 18, that's gone. A negative 18 plus 18, that's also gone. So m squared is equal to 0. I take the square root of each side. I take the square root of each side. So here, I would have square root symbol and square root symbol. What's the square root of m squared? M. The square root of 0? 0. So the solution is 0. Okay, so here we have b squared plus 12 is equal to 5. B squared plus 12 is equal to 5. We want to get the b squared by itself, so we got to get rid of that 12. So we're going to say minus 12 minus 12. Once again, minus 12 minus 12. 12 minus 12 goes to 0, so that's gone. And then 5 minus 12 will give me a negative 7. So I want to do the same thing. I want to take the square root of both sides. But when I do that, the square root of b squared is b. But negative real numbers do not have real square roots, so there is no solution. That's because I cannot do the square root of a negative number. So since I can't do the square root of a negative number, my answer is no solution. Okay, now that we went through example 1, you should have a better idea of what the key concept means. Solving x squared is equal to d by taking square roots. If d is greater than 0, then x squared equals d has two solutions. That would have been a. So in other words, x would end up equaling to a positive or negative square root of d. If d is equal to 0, then x squared is equal to d, and it has one solution at x is equal to 0. That would have been example b. If d is less than 0, then x squared is equal to d has no solutions. That would have been c, because remember now, you cannot take the square root of a negative number. So here they're showing you on one graph two solutions for d is greater than 0, one solution when d is equal to 0, and no solution when d is less than 0, or in other words, when d is negative. Simplifying square roots. In cases where you need to take the square root of a fraction whose numerator and denominator are perfect squares, the radical can be written as a fraction. For example, the square root of 16 over 25 can be written as 4 over 5 because 4 over 5 squared is equal to 16 over 25. In other words, what they're saying is the square root of 16 is 4. The square root of 25 is 5. So it can be rewritten or written as stated. Okay, let's go to example 2. Take the square root of a fraction. Solve 4 times z squared is equal to 9. Solution. Write the original equation and then divide each side by 4. So we got 4 times z squared is equal to 9. I want to get the z squared by itself. So I divide by 4. So when I divide by 4, when I divide by 4 here, and I divide by 4 there, I end up with the 4s canceled out, and I got z squared is equal to 9 over 4. After getting z squared is equal to 9 over 4, I then want to go through and take the square root of each side. So to do the square root of each side, I put a radical sign here and a radical sign there. Now, what's the square root of z squared? Z. And then what's the square root of 9 over 4? The square root of 9 over 4 will end up being, okay, the square root of 9 over 4 will end up being the square root of 9 is 3. The square root of 4 is 2. And I realize that I have a positive version and a negative version. So once again, the square root of z squared is z. The square root of 9 over 4 ends up being a positive or negative 3 over 2. So the solutions are a negative 3 over 2 and a positive 3 over 2. Approximating square roots. In cases where d in the equation x squared is equal to d is not a perfect square or a fraction whose numerator and denominator are not perfect squares, you need to approximate the square root. A calculator can be used to find an approximation. Example 3. Approximate solutions of a quadratic equation. Solve 3x squared minus 11 is equal to 7. Round the solution to the nearest hundredth. Solution. 3x squared minus 11 is equal to 7. We want to get the x squared by itself. So we're going to get rid of 11 first. So we're going to say plus 11 plus 11. That means 11 is going to cancel out, and 7 plus 11 is 18. So now we got 3x squared is equal to 18. We're going to divide each side by 3. Divide each side by 3, we end up with x squared is equal to 6. 3 divided by 3 is 1, that's gone. 18 divided by 3 is 6. Now we take the square root of each side. Okay, so I got my square root symbol over the x squared, and I got my square root symbol over the 6. The square root of x squared is x. The square root of 6, after using a calculator, comes out to be 2.45. And once again, I have to remember that 2.45 is a positive version and a negative version. And also remember, they told you to round off to the nearest hundredth. So the solutions are about a negative 2.45 and a positive 2.45. Example 4, solve a quadratic equation. Solve 6 times x minus 4 squared is equal to 42. Round the solution to the nearest hundredth. 6, we write the original equation, 6 times x minus 4 squared is equal to 42. We divide each side by 6. So, when we divide by 6, we divide by 6 on this side and on that side. We end up with 6 divided by 6 is 1, so we're left with just x minus 4 squared. And then 42 divided by 6, well, that's 7. So now I have x minus 4 squared is equal to 7. Now notice I have the squared term by itself. I have the squared term by itself. That's why we ended up dividing by that 6. So since I got the squared term by itself, I can now take the square root of each side. So square root here and square root there. Okay, so now what's the square root of x minus 4 squared? X minus 4. Once again, what's the square root of x minus 4 squared? X minus 4. We take the square root of 7 and we leave it just like it is. We'll write it as a positive and a negative version, plus or minus the square root of 7. Now we're trying to solve for x, so we're going to get rid of this 4. So we're going to say plus 4 here, and plus 4 on this side. Okay. After doing that, the 4s were canceled out, and we're left with just x. Now we're going to write 4 plus or minus the square root of 7. Once again, 4 plus or minus the square root of 7. The solutions are 4 plus the square root of 7, which is equal to 6.65, and 4 minus the square root of 7, which is equal to 1.35. So in other words, use your calculator and find the value for the square root of 7. All right, after using your calculator, you should have found that the square root of 7 is about 2.64. So just think, they're saying 4 plus 2.64. You could have rounded this off to 2.65. Same here, 2.65. But now you're saying 4 minus 2.65, which would be about 1.35. Example 5, solve a multi-step problem, sports events. During an ice hockey game, a remote-controlled blimp flies above the crowd and drops a numbered table tennis ball. The number on the ball corresponds to a prize. Use the information in the diagram to find the amount of time that the ball is in the air. Solution, step 1. Use the vertical motion model to write an equation for the height in feet of the ball as a function of time, t, in seconds. H is equal to a negative 16 t squared plus v time t plus s. That's the vertical motion model. H is equal to a negative 16 t squared plus 0 times t plus 45. Substitute for v and s. Okay, now in the equation, we got 45 from the distance here. Okay, and then the velocity of 0, that comes about because when an object is dropped, it has an initial velocity, it has an initial vertical velocity of 0 feet per second. So that's where the 0 came from. And once again, the 45 came from the height of the blimp itself. Step 2. Find the amount of time the ball is in the air by substituting 17 for H and solving for T. So in place of H, we put 17. Now we're going to solve for T. All right, so we want to get the T squared by itself. So the first thing we're going to get rid of is the 45. So we subtract 45 from each side. After doing so, the 45 is gone. And we end up with 17 minus 45, which is a negative 28. So now we got a negative 16 t squared is equal to a negative 28. We're going to divide each side by a negative 16. So here we divide by 16, and here we divide by 16. So I end up with t squared. Actually, I'm dividing by a negative 16. So I end up with t squared is equal to 28 over 16. Remember now, that 16 was negative, so a negative divided by a negative will be positive, so the whole thing ends up being positive. So now we got t squared is equal to 28 over 16. Okay, now we take the square root of each side. The square root of t squared is t. The square root of 20 over 16, when we use a calculator, comes out to be 1.32. Now don't forget, we have a positive version and a negative version, so it's plus or minus. But we're talking about how much time the ball's in the air, so the negative value makes no sense. That's why the answer is going to end up being just a positive 1.32 seconds. All right, that concludes today's lesson, so we may get right to work.